live from New York, it's The Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null, on the road, speaking over telephone today. We're going to talk about health and healing. Then we're going to go to some interesting mini audio clips that I think you'll find of importance. My guest in the second part of our program is John Whitehead, and he is a constitutional scholar and attorney. And I want to start this part of the year talking about the erosion of our civil rights last year and what we can reasonably expect this year. If you speak with the average person, do you care about what is happening with the erosion of your civil rights? Most people will shrug and say, they don't know what you're speaking about. And indeed, unless you've been a victim of things such as, wiretapping or asset forfeiture or profiling, you probably wouldn't consider it an important issue. It is. So we're going to talk about that in depth. We're also going to take a look at some other issues, including we're going to play today an audio clip from a scholar who had spent 30 years in the CIA, and he's being grilled, but the legislators don't like how he is saying things. And so, as they would typically do, interfere and berate him, but it's his response in return. He's not going to take it. He lets them know that. So we're going to hear from Michael Shear on this particular issue. Also, if time permits, some myths that we live by. And then I'll open our lines up for your feedback a little later on in the program after we've spoken with our guest, and that'll be the part that I think you'll find interesting. I have a lot of good audio clips that I'm going to be playing in the upcoming days, and I also have some outstanding guests lined up for you. But we always begin with the latest on healing. And we're going to talk about a study that was reported in GreenMed Info about reversing insulin resistance with some common foods. Now, for those of you who've been on protocols that I put you on, then this is already common to you. But for the average person, it could be a lifesaver. I have a friend of many years who didn't pay attention to his diabetes. He thought, well, it's not that bad because you can't always feel it. And I said, it's very easy to reverse diabetes, three things: proper supplementations to maintain your normal blood sugar and repair damage to your kidneys and your liver, and stimulate your nerves, walking and exercising each day, a good diet, cleansing and detoxification, stabilizing foods. Simple enough, and he didn't do it. Now this person who I've known a long time is at home, under hospice care, not able to walk because he's got diabetic neuropathy. He's had multiple little lesions on his leg. He's lucky it hasn't become gangrene, probably will. And all this happened within a period of 14 months. That's how quickly you can go downhill. Now consider this. Right now in the United States, we have diabetic about close to 30 million, pre-diabetic about 70 million. That's 100 million Americans, and a lot of those are children. Something we've never experienced before. So it's a serious condition. And when you do have insulin resistance, you're far more susceptible to heart attack, stroke, and cancers. So anything that can improve insulin resistance is really good. And right now, we're estimating 80 million Americans have insulin resistance that can lead to diabetes. And generally, that doesn't take long. If you add in being overweight, you really speed up how long it takes to get to diabetes. So what can we do to keep our blood sugars normal, to lose weight, to prevent premature aging, to reduce high blood pressure and heart disease and cancer risks? Well, here's some thoughts. First, start with turmeric. Turmeric, T-U-R-M-E-R-I-C. It's a completely effective in preventing diabetes. In fact, there was a study that found curcumin, cure, C-U-R, cumin, C-U-M-I-N, which is the active and compound in turmeric, was 500 to 100,000 times more effective than the prescription drug metformin at activating glucose uptake. So I believe people should be taking 500 to 1,000 milligrams of curcumin in divided doses, meaning once in the morning, once in the afternoon, once in the evening, 300 milligrams each time. If you're completely well, because it is so good for your entire body. And in another study with 240 pre-diabetic adults, they were given 250 milligrams of curcumin or a placebo every day, and after 9 months, not one of those taking curcumin developed diabetes, but 16.4% of the placebo group did. In other words, the curcumin was 100% effective at preventing type 2 diabetes. So let's make that our number one nutrient intake of the day. Number two would be ginger. Now, ginger is good for so many things. It can calm an upset stomach. It's good if you're out on the ocean and you're getting seasick. It's, a lot of people do. I'll never forget the time that I had a bunch of friends over to my home in Lake Apakong, and it was early in the morning, and they all wanted to go out to Montauk. I said, that's a long drive. It's an hour in to the city, then another almost 3 hours out, 4 hours. You want to go? Yeah. We want to go out there and, you know, go out and see the on the water. Okay. So we made that long trip and got out there, rented a boat, small boat, and went out. We weren't even half a mile from shore. And I'm sitting in the back of the boat guiding it, working it. And they're all kind of up the front and quiet, and I thought they were looking at the waves. And then I start seeing on both sides, when I'm in the back, come back, their breakfast in the water. And after about an hour of this, and they didn't move. They were so sick. But these are kind of like macho people, and they didn't want to admit it. I said, have you all had enough? Oh, yeah, we've had enough. We've seen it. Great. I turned around and came back. And what I did is I went into a place, the Amagansett Market, and I got some ginger, and I shaved off some, and I had them chew on the ginger. So they chewed on a piece, each one a piece of ginger, but inch piece, and they were fine. It calmed their stomachs. And that's why ginger ale was given in hospitals, because it keeps people calm. However, that's lightweight use. If you really want the heavy-duty industrial benefits, the functionality of ginger, then you juice it, ideally 1 teaspoon in the morning. Now, you can juice this once a week. You can keep it, put some vitamin C in it, and it'll preserve for a week, or you can keep it in the freezer and bring it in the refrigerator the night before. And you take 1 teaspoon, and you add that to 1 teaspoon of lemon juice, and also put in there whatever else you want as a, depending upon what you're wanting it for. It can be bee propolis, can be wild oregano oil, a little silver. If you're trying to overcome a cold, sore throat, you can add to it, but ginger is great. But for diabetics, listen up, please. Ginger lowers your fasting blood glucose. And there was a randomized double-blind placebo-controlled trial of 88 diabetics, and they were divided into two groups. Each one received a placebo, while the other received 3 1-gram capsules of ginger powder. And you can buy ginger in powdered capsules also. After 8 weeks, the ginger group reduced their fasting blood sugar level, but the placebo group increased their fasting blood sugar level by 21%. So, ginger lowers fasting blood sugar level. And in another study, researchers provided 1,600 milligrams, that's 1.6 grams of ginger, and that improved 8 markers of diabetes, including insulin sensitivity. And many studies prove the value of ginger for diabetes. And then let's add in number three, cinnamon. Less than a half a teaspoon a day reduces your blood sugar level. Most people are not aware of that. They like cinnamon just for the taste of it, but my goodness, you know, instead of just putting it on oatmeal, which is fine, put it into a smoothie. Cinnamon is one of the oldest spices, most popular spices, and it's been used for the millennia. Mainly as a flavoring agent, but in other countries it's used for its medicinal values. And it normalizes your blood sugar levels in type 2 diabetes by improving the ability to respond to insulin. There was a meta-analysis, meaning meta means many studies. In fact, in this case, it was 8 clinical studies shows that cinnamon or cinnamon extracts lower fasting blood glucose levels. And cinnamon works in part by slowing the rate at which the stomach empties after eating. And in one study, subjects ate about a cup of rice pudding with or without a teaspoon of cinnamon. And adding the cinnamon slowed the rate of the stomach by 34% emptying, and that significantly slowed the rise in blood sugar levels. So even less than a half a teaspoon a day reduces your blood sugar. And then we have olive leaf extract. And the results of olive leaf extract were virtually comparable to the very high-use medicine metformin. And at the University of Auckland, researchers proved that olive leaf extract, which you can buy at 1,000 milligram capsules or tablets, decreases insulin sensitivity. And this was a randomized, double-blind, placebo-controlled study of overweight men divided into 2 groups. One received the capsules containing olive leaf, and the other received a placebo. And after 3 months or 12 weeks, the olive leaf extract lowered insulin resistance by an average of 15%. It also increased the productivity of the insulin-producing cells in the pancreas by 28%. There's no medicine that could do that, and this is all non-toxic. By the way, it also kills bacteria that you don't want, and viruses. That's how good olive leaf extract is. And then one of my favorites is berries. I'm a big believer in berries. You would not believe how much berries I consume in a day. And I don't tell people how much I consume because I don't want them to go and try on their own and then overdo it. But the berries, the more berries, the better in your diet. And diabetes is based upon an increase in the blood sugar level, and berries have low glycemic factors. Studies show that the body needs less insulin for sugar balance after a meal of berries is also eaten. And in a study of healthy women in Finland, subjects were asked to eat white and rye bread with or without a selection of different pureed berries. And the starch in the bread alone spikes after meal glucose levels. So remember, every time you have bread with a meal, you're spiking your blood sugar. That's a danger. Diabetics shouldn't have that. You could have, let's say, sprouted, completely 100% sprouted bread, like Ezekiel's, or a seam bread, that's okay because there's no gluten in it. There's no refined carbohydrate. It's all sprouts. But any kind of processed bread, now you're going to see your blood sugar just go right up. So get rid of the bread. And the research found that adding berries to the bread significantly reduces the after-meal insulin spike. Well, what if we did 2 things? What if we added berries, like just even at the end of a meal, you have yourself a little dessert. Now, what would be the great dessert to have? Take some papaya and the core of watermelon. You're getting papain, you're getting bromelain, terrific enzymes for helping digestion. But also, these are very good anti-inflammatories. They heal the stomach lining and the intestinal lining. They're extremely beneficial. Throw in some wild blueberries and some pomegranate. And make yourself a little slurry, a little smoothie, just with the berries. You might want to add a little liquefaction in there. You could put any of your favorite, you know, almond milk, rice milk, whatever you want in there, and drink that at the end of a meal. That will actually help the meal digest. And if you really want to go out, throw some cinnamon, anise, and fennel, either the powder or the seeds, into that, and that really increases digestibility. And then you have also spirulina increases insulin sensitivity by 225%. Now, I know a lot of you in this audience, probably thousands of you, are getting the benefits of spirulina because you're taking it each day in powder form. And good for you. You're way on the right side of health and healing because spirulina is just absolutely terrific. There was a randomized study of insulin-resistant patients, and they compared the spirulina powder and soy to control insulin levels. And they assigned a group of patients, 19 grams a spirulina. That's about three-quarters of an ounce. That's maybe a half a teaspoon a day. And the others receive 19 grams of soy. And after 8 weeks, the spirulina group on average increased their insulin sensitivity by 224%, while the soy group increased their insulin sensitivity by 60%. Both are better than any medicine in the world. They're both good, but spirulina is a superstar. In addition, 100% of the spirulina groups improved their insulin sensitivity, while only 69% of the soy group did. And then you have what is called berberine, B-E-R-B-E-R-I-N-E. It's as good as three different diabetic drugs. It's a bitter compound, and it's found in the roots of several plants, including golden seal, barberry, and Oregon grapefruit. And it is as good as prescription diabetes drugs. Now, your doctor's not going to tell you that because, A, they don't know it. And not that they don't want you to be healthy, it's just that they're going to tell you what they know. And they know pharmacology, but they don't get the results and their side effects with this medicine. The Chinese researchers compared berberine to metformin in a pilot study on patients, and they found the herb lowered blood sugar levels just as well as metformin in just 3 months. But there was no side effects, and they had the benefit of decreased fasting blood glucose and after-meal blood glucose. And in the same study, researchers gave berberine to 48 diabetics for 3 months. After only 1 week, it lowered both fasting and post-meal blood glucose levels by 45%. And other researchers have conducted a meta-analysis looking at 14 separate studies, including 1,068 participants, and they found that berberine performed just as well as metformin and glipizide, and those are two of the top diabetic drugs on the market. And of course, there's always a place when you're talking about wonderful outcomes with black seed oil. Nigella, N-I-G-E-L-L-A, sativa, S-A-T-I-V-A. Just 2 grams, mind you, 28.35 grams to an ounce, you're talking about a tiny amount, reduces insulin resistance. They gave 94 diabetic patients 1, 2, or 3 grams of black cumin seed in capsules, and they found that the dose of 2 grams per day significantly reduced fasting blood glucose and insulin resistance. And so it's a natural remedy, and it's good for everything, and it's been used for thousands of years. Back in ancient times, it was referred to as Roman coriander, or black sesame, or black cumin, or black caraway. It's gone by different names. But it is one of the best of the best. Also, there's now been a definite link between fast foods and the bad cholesterol. It's been reinforced, according to Tim Cutliffe in a post. Regular, quote, fast food consumption means more calories, less nutrients, researchers published in the Archives of Disease in Children. So when you're eating and your kids are eating fast foods, according to this research done at Research Institute St. George University of London, you're going to have really bad blood chemistry. And that can stay with you, and that can lay down the framework for coronary heart disease in children. So even if it requires you properly educating, being very patient when the kids yell and scream and throw stuff at you, just realize you're doing something now that can make a difference in their life later on. And we need this kind of discipline. We need to re-educate our entire population as to what's wrong with our foods. And by the way, from the Casa Grande Dispatch, they're talking about U.S. seniors taking way too many unneeded drugs. It's literally a drug epidemic. And for decades, experts have warned that older Americans over the age of 40 are taking too many unnecessary drugs and often prescribed by multiple doctors for dubious or unknown reasons. Researchers estimate that 25% of people over 65 to 69 take at least 5 prescription drugs to treat chronic conditions, a figure that jumps to nearly 46% of those between 70 and 79. And doctors say it's not uncommon to encounter patients taking more than 20 drugs to treat acid reflux and heart disease and depression and insomnia. And unlike the overuse of opiate painkillers, the polypharmacy problems has attracted little attention, even though its hazards are well documented. And unfortunately, we're not reversing this. I just saw a study today that this year we will be taking more painkillers than ever before. We'll also be eating more meat than ever before. We'll be eating more bread and calories. We'll become fatter than ever before. We will drink more alcohol than ever before. And younger people would drink as much as 10 times the amount of alcohol of the post-World War II baby boomer generation. So you don't have to be very creative to figure out what the likely outcome for all these people is going to be. We're going to get sicker, fatter, more inflamed, and the medical community will have absolutely zero impact on any of this because there's no preventative model. That's what we have to come to ourselves. I'm Gary Null. That's the latest on health and healing. We're 21 minutes into our program. We're going to take a break and come right back. Please stay with us. I'm on location. I'm Gary Null, and I want to play you a clip. This is a short clip. It's a former CIA 30-year analyst who headed the bin Laden file, and he is being challenged by members of Congress. So I thought you'd like to hear the interplay on foreign policy and what he has to say. Please listen in.
In Syria could quickly ignite into a larger conflict, and the war has already killed over 100,000 people and forced over 6 million from their homes. American and Russian warships are both in the region, and each nation is supporting opposing sides in the conflict. Russia's last foreign military base outside the former Soviet Union is located inside Syria's borders. Hezbollah and Iran are both threatening to attack Israel if the U.S. takes military action against Assad's government in Damascus. Members of Al-Qaeda are known to be among the rebels being supported by the Obama administration. And like a Mexican standoff, the tragic conflict could go in any direction. Michael Scheuer, he's a historian and a former CIA analyst, and for 3 years he headed the Osama bin Laden tracking unit at the CIA's Counterterrorism Center. He is the author of the book Imperial Hubris. In 2007, bin Laden said Scheuer's book revealed the reasons behind U.S. losses in the war on terrorism. Michael Scheuer is our guest today to provide insight and analysis into the crisis that is now growing in Syria. Welcome to WHDT, Michael.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for having me.
Now, Michael, President Obama just recently stated he's going. He wants to go into the conflict. He wants to use military force in Syria. He's also said he will be seeking congressional approval to do so. If that happens, who will our military be fighting? Who will they be fighting in Syria? Who are the rebels?
Well, if they're going to fight Assad, then they're going to fight in favor of a group of people who have been rebelling against Assad, but whose military power to oppose Assad comes strictly from Al-Qaeda and other mujahideen who have come to the area since the war in Syria began. So, in essence, I think Mr. Kucinich said the other day the Air Force will be flying cover for Al-Qaeda.
So, okay, so to be absolutely clear, our military will be fighting alongside the Mujahideen and Al-Qaeda against a sovereign government in Syria.
Right. Our Air Force will be supporting the same people whose brethren killed between Iraq and Afghanistan about 9,000 American soldiers and Marines. Yes.
And to provide some perspective, we did the same thing in Afghanistan when the Russians were fighting the Mujahideen. Is that correct?
In the sense that we helped lead the Russians there, absolutely. We had very little control over the Mujahideen, unfortunately, but they certainly did the job on the Russians.
Now, what role is Al-Qaeda actually playing in the conflict?
The role they generally play, sir, Al-Qaeda is an organization that's meant to support other people's insurgencies. They provide training, they provide weaponry, they provide, most of all, on-the-ground leadership, people who are experienced at the non-commissioned officer and field grade officer levels. And I think in this case, they're also bringing in more of their sort of infantry people, because the resistance in Syria was very short of experienced military manpower. And so Al-Qaeda and its allies, and I think it's important to stress the allies part of it. There are people coming from Somalia. There's people coming from Egypt. They're not all Al-Qaeda, but Al-Qaeda certainly is the core organizer of the military side of the resistance.
Now, what has been the role so far of the United States in this war?
Well, sticking our nose where it doesn't belong, Gary, is what's happened so far. You know, if you step back and look at what's going on in Syria, everybody who America identifies as its enemies are killing each other at the moment. We dislike Syria, we dislike Iran, and we dislike Hezbollah. Al-Qaeda and the resistance are killing them. We dislike Al-Qaeda, and Hezbollah, Syria, and Iran are killing them. So in many ways, we have the best of both all worlds in Syria, and now we're going to stick our nose in it to support people who will be far worse than Assad.
Now, some would say, let them kill each other. If both of the sides are not friendly to the United States, why is the United States insisting to stick our nose in the situation?
I think for a couple of reasons, mostly because we're owned by foreign governments. The reason that Obama delayed a week was to allow the Israeli lobby in this country to go around the country and lobby the congressmen. I don't think they can change the opinion of the American people in a week, but they have so much influence with the Congress because of campaign contributions, because of the threat of using the media against them, that they probably can swing a majority to vote in favor of the war. On the other side, the Saudis, who are highly invested in the United States economically, both in our debt and in property, have probably been ringing off the wall at various arms makers in the United States to order aircraft and other weaponry. And those arms makers, in turn, use their lobbyists to press the Congress. So between those two foreign interests who have ungodly influence with the government,
all right, that's the setup. We're going to go to Congress in a moment. I wanted to hear his position. So let's summarize what he said. The United States and its allies, including Saudi Arabia and Turkey and Great Britain and France, and also you could add in there Kuwait and United Arab Emirates, Qatar and Bahrain, they have all been providing weapons, training and protection to Al-Qaeda, Al-Nusra, and of course ISIS. ISIS indirectly, but when you give the weapons and you give the training to one group of terrorists, then other groups of terrorists work with them. And that's why ISIS was so well armed right up until this moment. So on the one hand, if we really cared about terrorism and ending it, we would stop supporting our allies with arms and intelligence so that they wouldn't pass them on and train and protect. As an example, the United States did not defeat, contrary to what this president and his administration wants to take credit for, they did not defeat, just like America's didn't defeat Germany in World War II. That's a complete, total, 100% myth. It was the Russians who did that. I'll get to that later in one of my historical reviews of real scholarship and real history. Let me say that again so we're real clear on this. The United States did not defeat Nazi Germany. It was the Russians who did it. We took the credit. We got the benefit from the Marshall Plan, and being the number one industrial nation in the world because of that, the after building of Italy and France and Germany and Japan, etc. But just like we did with MIS, we are saying, oh, we beat ISIS. We didn't beat ISIS. The Obama administration, complicit up to its eyeballs, was supplying knowingly $500 million to the Free Syrian Army. And it's really not Free Syrian Army. It's a terrorist army. Everything about it's terrorist. These are mercenaries coming from around the world. You pay them, and they go and fight. And the people who have only ideological reference, those are the ones that went into Libya and started that conflict with the United States and Hillary Clinton behind it. And, by the way, one of the largest open market slave trading in the world now is in Libya. And then they did the same thing in Syria. And for 14 months, not a single truck was blown up of 12,000 trucks going across from Turkey into Libya, into Iraq, stealing their oil, bringing it back and selling it on the black market through Erdogan's son for $20 a barrel when it was going for $80 to $100 a barrel in the open market. We didn't destroy one. When Russia came in, first thing they did, they killed off all those transportation because that was the money that was used to fund up to $1 to $4 million a week of ISIS. So he's calling it out. He's not going into the detail like I just did, but he's saying this is what we've created. And then he's saying, well, why didn't anyone complain about Israel or anyone else? Because Israel has one of the best lobbies in the United States. They own our Congress. They've owned the White House. We don't have money for the inner city of Brooklyn, inner city of Detroit, inner city of Camden, New Jersey, Compton, California. We don't have a place for the homeless people by the thousands in California to sleep at night, but we've got $4 billion a year that we give, plus technology above and beyond that, to Israel. Why? Because it's the only democracy in the Middle East? No, that's not true. So that's the first part of what he was saying. Here's the second part when he sang it before Congress and being challenged on it.
If we come to a place where we can have a discussion that says supporting Israel is essential to the U.S. security, supporting Saudi Arabia is important, vital to U.S. security, having U.S. troops in Muslim countries is vital to U.S. security, fine. But also tell the American people that costs come with that. Right now, we've spent 17 years in this war, and the American people still think we're fighting a bunch of long-haired, bearded, goat-eating madmen. And we're at a terrible disadvantage that we impose on ourselves, sir. And I would finish a too long a statement by simply saying that we must stop the idiocy of democracy spreading. If you want to fight forever, keep trying to impose women's rights, secularism, the paganism of American culture, contemporary culture, on a religious civilization, sir.
Yeah, and I'll take Stephen to make a comment. Professor Troy, I've known you over the years, but I have to take sharp disagreement with your position about our support of Israel. I believe it is essential that the United States, for our security, continue to support Israel. I believe that if we back away from Israel or Jordan, for instance, using those countries, Morocco, as examples, that Al-Qaeda will find some other excuse. I mean, we can find any number of reasons. I can tell you during the 1990s, it's from after Iraq, but between 1995 and 2001, the only time the Americans used force overseas was to defend Muslims against Christians in Bosnia and in Kosovo. And yet the response by Al-Qaeda to that was to attack us on September 11th. So I think we make a mistake if we think we can somehow appease Al-Qaeda by taking away whatever they're...
Not at all a matter of appeasement, Mr. King, at all. If it was up to me, I'd dump the Israelis tomorrow.
I know you would. I know.
But I have all I worry about is the continuing preaching of American politicians to the American people that our relationship with the Israelis doesn't cause us to have dead Americans and extraordinary expenses in fighting the Muslim world.
I would just say we would have more dead Americans if we didn't stand by our allies in the Middle East.
Well,
we'd just be encouraging Al-Qaeda to take advantage of us. I think that...
Our allies in the Middle East are mostly totalitarian, sir, and they have been for 50 years.
There are not that many good people in the world. The fact is you have to work with those who work with us. And if I had the choice between dealing with the Israelis and Al-Qaeda, I work with Israel. If I had the choice between dealing with Jordan or Al-Qaeda, I'd deal with Jordan. And the fact is that you can find any number of excuses why Al-Qaeda is going to come after us.
No, sir, you can't.
Yes, I think you can.
No, you can't,
can.
Sir.
You certainly
Osama bin Laden would have been a terrific American politician because he stays on message. There's only one message that comes out of Al-Qaeda, and it's
that's the message they're using now. If it's not, there'll be some, if we pull out of Israel, if we
you
stop
have
supporting,
to be panicked.
No, I'm going to say, if we stop supporting Israel, then the message will be,
you have
America,
to,
America was cowardly, America was backed away, they're not going to stand by their allies. It can always, it's the flip side of everything, and I would rather stand with positive elements like Israel and back down.
I'm a bear of little brain, sir, but you got to go with what you go with at the moment. These people are fighting for something substantive, for something religious. And they're not fighting us for what reason do you suppose they're going to come up with? Because we have Hollywood? I would like to fight Hollywood. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, they're not going to fight us because we have women in the workplace. That's an insanity. What they're fighting us about is what we do. And we don't have to stop what we're doing, sir. But we have to realize the cost.
And I think it'd be worse if we stop what we're doing, and that's my point.
Well, that's fine. Tell the American people that.
There's also, of course, what you're asking for, and I think that cost would be a lot greater.
I don't think so, sir.
Well,
it couldn't be worse than it is now.
We have to disagree.
You know, you're presiding over a bankruptcy. What can be worse? And what has been the goal of Al-Qaeda since it was formed? To bankrupt the United States. Who's winning today, sir? We're done like dinner.
We're winning, and we'll continue to win unless we take the advice of people like
sir,
you.
Sir, you are exactly wrong. We are losing. Two U.S. field armies were defeated by men in the field with weapons from the Korean War.
The fact is, we have not been successfully attacked since September 11th.
The fact is, sir, we had two military defeats overseas.
The fact is, we have not been successfully attacked since September 11th.
Sir, that's a goofy argument.
Like you.
That is a goofy argument, sir.
I hate to gavel down the...
Well, I'm sure you're an expert on goofiness, so I yield back.
I appreciate the gentleman's spirited debate.
Again, I want to come back to understand some of the things you said. Before I do that, and I just want to mention this quickly, I find your position on our alliance with Israel as very troubling. It won't surprise you to tell you that I disagree with you. And you spent 17 years, is that right, or something like that, as a CIA analyst?
Over 20, sir.
Okay, over 20.
Not as an analyst, I ran operations, sir.
Okay. Would you say there's a large number of CIA analysts or employees who agree with your position?
I wouldn't dare to speak for anybody but myself, sir.
Well,
only a fool would know that our relationship with Israel causes us war with Muslims.
Well, my question is fairly simple.
Yes, sir.
You worked with hundreds of employees.
Yes,
those,
sir.
You certainly
didn't work with any fools, sir.
You certainly had conversations with many of them. I'm asking for your opinion of, are there a large number who agree with you on this?
I'm not a McCarthyite, sir. I'm not going to say anything about that to you, sir.
Okay, well, I'm going to take that as non-responsive because it's a fairly simple question, and
it's
I don't
fairly
think...
fairly none of your business about what my conversations with other people are about, sir.
I'm not asking for specifics of those conversations. I'm asking for your opinion of your experience, where there are a large number...
Okay, when was the last time you heard someone say, sir, it's none of your business? The fact is, Scher's right. There is a cost that we have refused to acknowledge by who we choose around the world. We've chosen dictators. In fact, my guest is on the line now, and I want to go to him because he is also a person who champions freedom of choice, the independence of individuals away from being governed at every aspect, including ideologically and politically. John Whitehead, he's a constitutional scholar, a lawyer, and he's written a great deal as a civil attorney and debated and practiced widely in constitutional law and human rights for the persecuted and the oppressed. And back in 1982, founded the Rutherford Institute, which is focused upon nonprofit civil liberties and human rights organizations headquartered in Charlotte. And he's also the author of Battlefield America, The War on the American People. His website is Rutherford, that's RUTHERFORD.org. Nice to have you with us today, John.
Hey, thanks for having me on, sir.
John, I'm always interested when I hear someone actually stand up to members of Congress in a strong and healthy debate to let them know, I'm not here as part of your dog and pony show. There's a consequence to the people that we allied with. And when you look at the people we've allied with historically, they've all been either corrupt, they've been anti-democratic, and like you said, stop spreading democracy around the world because we're imposing our system upon others without any concern about how they've lived for thousands of years. And yet no one in Congress dared challenge him, because if they did, or agree with him, because if they did, their phone would be ringing off by AIPAC and other organizations that are strong lobbyists and supporters of Israel, which is their right. Your thoughts on how easy it is for members of Congress and the White House and the judiciary to align themselves with anti-humanistic, anti-spiritual, and anti-common sense positions?
Oh, we've been doing that for, I have to go back. When I first was a young lawyer and did some cases up on Capitol Hill in Washington, D.C., I met a number of congressmen who told me that if anybody says hello to you in the morning in Washington, D.C., it's a money hello. In other words, they're doing it because they're going to profit off of it. And I think, you know, I may offend some of your listeners, but our government is corrupt in that way. I mean, you have people, I mean, I don't think we really have a truly representative government. I think people think we do. But when you have these people that are in Congress for 20 years, 25 years, I'm a man for term limits. I think we should be turning those people over. We should be having younger people, people, poor people, not these people that are all backed by rich money bags that have one thing in interest. They want to make money. They make money off of war. You know that. You know, it's war is a money-making business. And as I've argued in my books, we're the new Roman Empire. We're attacking countries that have never attacked us. I mean, and dropping all these bombs on people. And, I mean, it's outrageous. And I want to use the word immoral. It's wrong what we do around the world. And I've argued that in some of my more recent pieces, all this money we're spending on war, why not spend it on the infrastructures? Why not spend it on helping the poor? There are 41 million people. This is a Guardian article came out not too long ago, a very good article, detailing there are 41 million people in this country, America, that live in abject poverty.
Abject.
We don't
poverty.
Take care of our own. And that to me, that's we're more money in the we have a corporate state. It's run by money, 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 money. They want your money. That was a great statement by John Carpenter, the film director. I just read an interview where he said, "I figured it out. All they want is our money." And I mean, I fight the battles daily with the average people out there just trying to get by, and it's tough. And I have money bags sitting at their so-called human beings in Washington, D.C. that don't have the time to even answer the phone or return an email now. So we're in a real mess. We're in a real mess.
John, let's go through some of the most important concerns you have that we all should be focused upon concerning our rights that are being challenged or eroded, and the American public, most of them, not all, are simply unaware of it, from civil forfeiture of our assets, how big that is, and yep. To people listening. And even right now, I was looking at photographs of new security apparatus in the city that every person that drives by or walks by, they're taking photographs of your face and yep. doing a whole metric analysis so they can put it into a database, and they're doing this on all the streets. People are unaware of this. Take us through the litany of what is wrong, not in the future. We're talking about now and how this may play out in the year 2018.
Yeah, I did a commentary, by the way, and people go to our website at rutherford.org. It's called Apocalypse Now. 2017 was another terrible, horrible, not very good, bad year. And when you're talking about surveillance, I mean, the Department of Homeland Security is deploying mandatory facial recognition scans at airports now, and they're improperly gathering biometric data on American citizens. The police now, you talk about asset forfeiture, that's where the police will arrest somebody for maybe running a stop sign or whatever. And if they think they have something in their car, money or whatever, they seize it and you can't get it back. Now, believe it or not, the police across the country are being gifted by the Department of Homeland Security with X-ray scanners, which they now can go by your car, the local police, and scan your car for anything they think might be contraband. And if it may not be contraband, but that doesn't matter. They can seize your car, they can seize your home. I've done a lot of writing on that, but that is something that's just, I mean, again, the so-called founding fathers, the ones that were really for freedom, would have been a shock, you know. And the Department of Homeland Security, by the way, has also got new enhanced license plate readers, which are reading your license plate wherever you go on the freeways, when you go through toll booths, when you enter cities. They're getting your facial pictures and scanning that. They're watching everything you're doing. And what I'm really concerned about it, and I'm writing something on it right now, is artificial intelligence has basically taken over. Algorithms are information, basically, in one data package. We're being studied now like we were, I don't know, data. That's all we are. We're data bits anymore. But if you make the slightest mistake now, you can get in a lot of trouble and get arrested by words you say or whatever. They're watching everything we're doing. And by the way, Facebook, Google, all work with these companies. Google is caught recording people's conversations on the phone. Everything you're saying is being recorded. I mean, George Orwell, if you remember his great book, 1984, he says, whatever you do, wherever you go, you're being watched. And that's where we're at today. It's a situation that I think that is really, really scary. And as I look at the country, it looks like we may be breaking down financially. I mean, national stores are going out of business. They're saying malls are going out of business. And I'm telling people, I did a commentary and a podcast on this. I don't know if you saw it, Gary, but that Pentagon 2030 video, have you had a chance to look at that?
Not yet, no.
Well, they issued it about 6 months ago, the Pentagon. It's only 5 minutes. It was directed by a Hollywood director who remains anonymous. It's very well done. But the Pentagon is predicting by 2030 all the major cities are going to break down, start breaking down, and they'll have to impose martial law. And it'll be with financial concerns, businesses shutting down, that we're seeing happening across the country. So it looks to me like that's more of a real scenario than I thought originally when I was looking at it, because financially, like I say, our infrastructure is breaking down, our roads, whatever, bridges. And a lot of young people, by the way, I mean, I have an intern program every Sunday where law students study with me. They have $200,000 worth of debt, and they can't get a job. They're having trouble working.
John, let's focus on what you just said a little deeper. And I'll give you background. My ranch is down in Florida, Southwest Florida, and I have a animal sanctuary where I take in animals and get them back to health and find them homes or beautiful places where they can spend the rest of their life. And I was prepared for a hurricane, but in spite of being prepared, I have had to spend thousands of hours nonstop cleaning up the debris. And the moment the storm was over, within hours, hundreds of trucks were all over the area going into people's homes, because the largest evacuation in Florida history, over 7 million cars. Now, you got to figure some of those cars had more than one person in it. Could have had a whole family. So you're talking about around 12 million, let's just say 12 million Floridians had to flee the state. Here's the problem, and this ties directly into what you're saying. Most of these people are not high-end, you know, condos in a building that they were inconvenienced by having to leave, but it wasn't going to sink. The building wasn't going to tip over. You're talking about middle class, working people, people in retirement communities, and now the insurance is only covering an average about 13%, 13 cents out of every dollar. These people don't have the savings to rebuild and repair. Most of the people didn't have backup generators, and if they did, there's little rinky-dinky generators that they have to put gas in. You ran out of gas, so that one day you're out of gas, you're out of power, and most people without power water. Now, that's the new norm. That was Category 4. Now imagine that they're now suggesting that this is going to happen once or twice a year. In fact, when the storm hit, when one big storm hit down in Louisiana, we were told that it was once in a 500-year storm. This is 14 months ago. We've had seven storms equal to that since. So now we have seven once-in-500-year storms. So, no, the whole climate is changing. Now, when that changes, there comes a time when a person says, well, my insurance isn't covering the damage. I got black mold. I can't live here with the black mold, or the county won't let me fix my house unless I do it by their standards. You have to have, you know, building standards. So they're going to start moving. You're going to have an exodus out of California now, and you did. California had a massive amount. New York State had over 160,000 people leave the state, more than came in. because they can't afford to live there. 51% of all the people living in Manhattan, New York City, are below the poverty level, at or below the poverty level. That's half the people. You never see their plight. You never see the plight of the people. You never have a documentary or a discussion of who's leaving. So now, today it was announced that Macy's is closing 11 stores, and Sears is closing an additional 100 in addition to the 250. Macy's says it's 12,000 employees. The Sears is going to be another 20,000 employees, and we're not even discussing that. Unless you listen to certain business channels, you wouldn't have known that there's 350 JCPenney stores closing and 11 Macy's, and that's just a tip of the iceberg. I have 51 corporations closing and what will be amount over a million people. So on the one hand, we're saying how great Wall Street is, and we're not looking at what we're becoming. We're becoming a country where in time, and I believe it'll be in the next 10 years, not the next 20, that you will have green zones for the very wealthy, protected, quality of life, and everyone else is outside of that, and then you've got Mad Maxville. Your thoughts?
Yep. Exactly. I mean, that's what the Pentagon video is about. It's very well done, by the way. If you watch it, it's frightening. But they're saying by 2030, and that's, what, 12 years away, they're saying that the country's going to break down. And other nations, they say, are going to experience the same situation. Yeah, I'm very, very concerned. And at the same time, you're seeing through the Trump administration the continued heavy armament of local police. They're getting ready. They're working with the FBI and the Department of Homeland Security and the Pentagon. And many police chiefs now are trained by the FBI. So you don't have local police and communities, but they're armed to the hilt, ready for something to happen. And it's a situation that if you wrote a sci-fi novel, it would be amazing. I mean, but again, I'd say, folks, go to our website, watch the podcast I did. I talk about the video. Watch that video, because the Pentagon, the U.S. government, is saying it's coming. We think by 2030, the country's going to break down. We're going to go into martial law. And by the way, those folks up on the hill there in Capitol Hill, they'll back it 100%. They always do. And the Pentagon, all those groups, you know, Gary, you know that. They're money-making ventures. Most of the work they do is outsourced to contractors who make millions and billions of dollars off of all the things they do in the war-making power and all the guns and tanks and MRAPs and weapons
John,
that local
where do
police
you see
have.
The,
so
where do you
we're in a government now, like I said, they want your money. They don't really care about freedom anymore. We don't. And let me tell you one thing. I deal with students in the summer from law schools that come to my program to study because they see what we do. And these are kids that when I graduated from law school, I had a year of constitutional law. A lot of these kids haven't even had constitutional law, and they don't even teach the First Amendment anymore in a lot of the law schools.
John, coming up in this year, what do you see as our one or two most important threats that will go unnoticed by the people and unreported by the media?
Well, you're going to see, one thing that I wrote about, another article is called A Tale of Two Americas. Through the Trump administration, they're expanding debtors' prisons, run by private companies, by the way. It's probation companies now. If you can't pay if you get arrested, and it may be a $500 fine, they add tacked fees on it. You end up paying $1,200. If you can't pay that, they put you in jail, and you work in a private prison where you make 12 cents an hour. There are women working in the fields 10 hours a day picking fruit for Walmart, making underwear for Victoria's Secret. And this is being promoted through it's always been promoted, by the way, in one way or another by former presidents. But under Jeff Sessions especially, it's just zooming forward. And now you have Sessions saying he's going to crack down on marijuana and send prosecutors in. And we're going to see more SWAT team raids for people smoking a joint. Watch out. I'm writing on that, by the way. You're going to see these police. You know, police now are shooting people. By the way, folks, I'm telling you, if you call 911, more and more people are getting shot by these guys showing up at your door. You better be careful what you have in your hand. If you have one guy flipping a pen when they arrive at the door, he gets shot. So they're all ready to go. They're being trained in the worst-case scenario in their institutions where they study, and they're ready for you, and people are getting shot and killed. Again, this is all detailed in what I write, but I agree with you. I think that we're like one step away from total chaos. And it looks like it's coming. And the current president, I think, who says that he watches at least four hours of television a day and is a junk food addict, I'm not sure he's paying attention. And I agree with Noam Chomsky. I think it was Noam Chomsky who said, it isn't Trump you got to worry about, it's who works for him. And people like Jeff Sessions really, really concern me.
You know, back in World War II, there was a little diminutive person. He was very powerful, tiny little guy, and wore glasses. Do you remember who he was? He ran the SS, ran the Gestapo, actually.
Yes.
Heinrich Himmler.
Yep.
We have our own versions of these, in my personal opinion, sociopaths. And we have to be very conscientious, because if you think that things are going to be the way they should be because we don't want someone stripping our constitutional rights, then we're living in delusion. It's already been stripped. They outlawed debtors' prisons back in the mid-1880s.
They did. 1833.
And it's back.
It's back.
You would think that this would be a big congressional debate, a Supreme Court debate. No, you can't put someone in prison. You cannot criminalize being poor. And yet today we're criminalizing being poor. And that's wrong. And the people in the White House, the Justice Department, they're all fully aware and they're embracing this because they've all got associations of people who've given them money, lobbyists, firms, Hillary Clinton, Bill Clinton, Barack Obama, all of them. All of them took money from the private prison industrial complex. And this big profits when you're able to have someone you pay 16 cents an hour making a product that you don't have to compete in the larger marketplace. So we're creating our own sweatshops right here in the United States, and then no one's paying attention to it until we do.
Well, the mainstream media never reports this stuff. You're right about that. But, you know, people have to understand, this country, America, spends $80 billion a year incarcerating 2.4 million people. And number one, 65% of the families that are caught up in this mess are unable even to pay for the basic needs such as food and housing. And 70% of these families are caring for children under 18 years of age. And again, 41 million people in this country live in abject poverty. And the question is, why? What's happened to the educational system? What's happened to the economical system?
John, let me invite you back to discuss that in depth. We're out of time now, and I thank you very much, John Whitehead from the Rutherford Institute, for being on. Thank you, sir. Thank you. He's a constitutional lawyer and scholar. I'm Gary Nolan. We're out of time. We'll keep hitting at it. We'll keep getting in their face, and we'll keep reminding them we, the people, still have a voice. Have a nice day, everyone.